Okay, today I'll be talking about hereditary. And for hereditary, there are a few things that you will need to know. First of all, what exactly is hereditary? How to go about, how was hereditary actually founded? Like, how did the scientists actually go about studying hereditary? And why is it important? So hereditary allows us, right, to determine your genome. What is genotypes? It's something similar to how the genes express certain kinds of traits in your body. And multiple alleles, there are the different kinds of variations which I'll talk about. And of course, mutation and selection. So first of all, what's a hereditary trait? A hereditary trait is basically characteristics that can be passed on from one generation to another. Meaning, if let's say, you have your parents have a particular trait of maybe having fair skin, how will this particular trait be passed on to you as the offspring, and so on and so forth. So some of these traits that we are aware of is like the hair type, the shape of your ear look, is it close or is it lob shape, the eye color, for example, is it blue color iris, brown color iris. Okay, the face shape, your chin shape, ability to roll your tongue is something that is also genetically decided, as well as your blood type. So what is exactly genetics is, it was founded by this guy called George Mendel. He's a monk. And one thing he observed was that he actually had a lot of plants. And through the plants, he also realized how come there were certain characteristics of the flower. Some of the flowers are white color, some of the flowers are pink color, and some of the flowers are purple color. So what he did was he actually took the pollen from the purple flower and sprinkled it onto the white flowers to observe how the offspring actually are like. So the offspring, they actually have an in-between color called pink color. And he took the offspring and to cross with another offspring, that means pink flower with another pink flower. And to his amaze, it generated a range of pink flower, purple flower, as well as white color flower. So that's where he started to also try to understand how the study of inheritance of characteristics are due to the transmission of genetic material from one generation to another generation. So when we look at hybrid inheritance, right? This one may look like a very big word, but if let's say we split the word up into a few shorter words, right? We look at the word mono. The word mono means only one characteristics that we are actually interested in. And what this actually does is hybrid inheritance, right? It refers to the inheritance of only one characteristic that has two contrasting forms. Contrasting form meaning very different formation. Like if one is pink color, the other must be white color. So that's what they meant by contrasting. And each of these characteristics is mainly controlled by a single gene. So let's say the gene for hair, it will have two different forms. For example, one for white hair, the other is for black hair. If let's say we look at skin color, one will have a darker tone, the other will have a lighter tone. So that's what we are looking for. And we call this contrasting form as alternate variations of the gene. And in this case, the term alleles is what is being used when we are talking about the two different forms. Okay, and any allele, right, the form, right, there must be a dominant and there must be a recessive. Now, what this actually meant is dominant means which one will be more powerful in terms of expression that you can see. Versus recessive is something that is weak, that it cannot be expressed. For example, if let's say for hair genes, right, if you have black hair, or you can also have white hair. So what we use to say is the black would be one allele, the white will be another allele for the gene of hair color. Then when we look at dominant and recessive, if let's say we say the black color hair is more dominant as compared to the white color hair, it means that if a person have the allele of this, you will see the person having more black hair as compared to white hair. So what he did was, he actually cross means in a way like you made lah. Two pure breeds of tall peas plant with a pure breed of dwarf plants. Meaning right, what he did was, one of the parent right is actually tall. The other parent is actually short. Okay, one that is very tall and one that is very short. And he forced both of them to mate together. One thing he realized that all plants eventually become very tall. That means they follow the parent that has, that is actually tall. And when that were to happen, he actually get this group of offspring, so we call it the F1 generation, to mate with one another, meaning all plants in the F1 generation pollinate the F1 generation plant. And then he observed the second generation, which is the F2 generation of offspring. Like how do they look like? And he realized that out of so many plants, the ratio, right, is that there is 75% of the plant is tall and 1%, yeah, and 25% is short. So when we look at this, right, think of the tall and dwarf for the first one as the your parents. And then the F1 generation is yourself, where you are the children of your parents. The F2 generation is how will your children look like? That means when you yourself is old enough to become parents, how would your child look like and the characteristics of it? So you will have a total of at least 3 generations. Okay? And what he, and from here, from his experiment, he realized that there, because there is small plants, right, that is actually tall as compared to the dwarf plants. Therefore, the tall plants, right, they are the allele for tall height of the plants is actually more dominant than the allele for dwarf. Okay? So the dominant trait is the tall, being tall. And the recessive trait is actually dwarf height. Okay. So in his model of hereditary, right, what he realized is that all these hereditary factors, like the genes, are responsible for the transmission of characteristics. And that each of these characteristics is generally controlled by a pair of factors in the cell. So if any of these two factors are different, only the dominant factor will actually show its effect. That means the dominant allele should be expressed. And that these two factors separate during gamete formation. What is gamete formation? Gamete formation is when you actually produce your sex cells. For example, if let's say you want to produce a sperm, one of the allele will actually go to the sperm. The other allele will go to the another sperm and so on and so forth. So even for egg, it's the same thing. Because in a normal cell, you have a diploid condition. Whereas for a gamete, okay, a sex cell, you have a haploid condition. And what will happen is, again, based on chance, during fertilization, that you bring two different alleles coming together. And only when the allele that is more dominant being expressed, it will overshadow the other allele. So we can see from this simple concept of how this is what happened at the F1 generation, where for the parent, right, the parent gamete, right, you would actually have, let's say, just now it was pure breed, right, both alleles are dwarfs. Whereas for the maybe another parent, both alleles to talk. And during gamete formation, the tall genes will start to split, where one of the sperm might carry tall, the other sperm might carry also the other tall allele. For the female, it can be one is a dwarf, the other is also a dwarf. So you have two eggs and two sperm. And then during the cross box, you can see here, right, is actually a random combination of the allele where we could see that the dwarf were made, will correspond to this height. This is the other box. Then let's say I use another color where the dwarf will pass on to this particular box. So over here you could see how the combination of mixing of the alleles will come together. Where for the first one, for the first box over here, when we look at A, you're actually getting the alleles of Thor from maybe the father and the dwarf from the mother. So when they combine, it's a Thor and dwarf. However, because Thor is more dominant than the dwarf, therefore the overall expression for this would be Thor. For B, if we look at B, same thing, the Thor will come from the father and the dwarf will come from the mother. And when again it actually combines, because Thor is being more dominant, it will actually be expressed. Now, it doesn't mean that all the recessive will come from the maternal, from the maternal side or the mother side. It is really by chance as to what are the characteristics held by the parent. Okay. So that is heredity. Now let's look at how, what are some basic knowledge for studying heredity, where we first look at a chromosome. So in our previous chapter, we learned about what's a DNA, how the DNA is slowly packed, wrapped around the proteins and slowly compact into the chromosome. So a chromosome is basically a rod-like structure visible in the nucleus during cell division. And it is mainly made up of DNA. So if we were to draw a chromosome, let's say a simple X like this, what we realize is this whole thing is actually made of DNA. And sometimes when you're looking at a gene, right, it can only apply to one small part of it. So let's say the one that's shaded is the gene for hair. And within the gene of hair, you can have two different alternate forms of the gene, which is the color of the hair. Like for example, black hair or white hair. So we call this black and white, right, as alleles. So you have a black allele or a white allele. Then, so do take note of how it is being broken down, where chromosome is the whole thing. Part of the chromosome is the gene, which is usually made up of a sequence of DNA. And within this same sequence of DNA, of the gene, let's say for hair color, we are able to actually have black alleles, which is the alternate form of the gene, or white alleles, which are the other alternate form of the gene or hair color. So a gene is mainly a unit of inheritance on a particular locus of a chromosome. The word locus comes from the word location. So we are talking about a location. A gene locus means where is that location of the gene within the chromosome. And a small segment of this DNA in a chromosome that contains a particular characteristic of protein of an organism will be expressed. If let's say it undergoes transcription and translation. Alleles is, the definition of alleles is the alternate form of the gene or different forms of the gene of the same gene. And they occupy the relatively the same position of the homologous chromosome, meaning if one chromosome is the one in blue, the homologous chromosome, the one in red, would also have the same position where the allele is at. And they generally occupy the same position. Letters are used to represent alleles, where the capital letter is used to represent dominant alleles. And the smaller letter is the recessive alleles. In exam, you will be required to know how to define what is an allele. You will be required to know how to define what is a gene. And last but not least, you will also need to know how to define what is a chromosome. So in general, you might be asked what is the relationship between a chromosome, a gene, and an allele. So homologous chromosomes, they tend to exist in pairs, where one of it in a pair will come from the male parent and the other one will come from the maternal, the mother the female parent. So what will happen is this only happens during fertilization, where part of the chromosome from the male gamete will merge with the part of the female gamete. Okay? And then they will have exactly the same sequence of the gene locus. So let's look at some of the terms again from a collective point of view, where in a cell inside the nucleus, you will have many chromatins. Okay? In a human being, you have a total of 23 pairs of chromosome, or a total of 46 chromosome. Each of these 23 pairs, right, they will have their own homologous chromosome, where one of it comes from the mother, one of it comes from the father. Now, within each of the chromosomes, you will also realize that they have their own specific sequence of genes. And within each sequence of genes, they will have two alternate forms, either one that is dominant or the other is recessive. They can also have both dominant alleles. That means you will see over here small a, or you can also have a big A for both sides. So those are what we call homologous dominant homozygous dominant genotypes. Well, if it's different, you call it heterozygous. So the phenotype is different from genotype. Phenotype is what is being expressed, in which you are able to see or observe with your naked eye. However, the word genotype is basically what the genes represent, or the genetic material that represents. Our eyes are not able to see the specific genes or the sequence of the nucleotide. That's why we use letters to represent the genotype. However, when we talk about phenotype, we usually use words or statements. For example, the color black, B-L-A-C-K, or maybe the color white. So those are the visible kind of characteristics that we can see. Later, we will see how to go about drawing it. So the phenotype of an organism is generally influenced by two things: the genes, which is the genotype, and second is the environment. Like for example, you have the genes for fair skin. However, let's say you stand under the hot sun, your skin will also get darkened. This is not because of what your gene is being expressed, but basically due to environmental effects. So what we can see is that genotype is the genetic makeup of an organism that is usually inherited from its parents. So genotype, genetic makeup from parents. Whereas just now, like I shared, there is also a situation where you can have both similar alleles versus different alleles. So if it's similar alleles, we call it homozygous. And homozygous what? If it's both are dominant alleles, it will be homozygous dominant. If it's both are weaker alleles, that means the recessive alleles, we call it homozygous recessive. However, if both alleles are different, that means one is dominant, the other is recessive, We tend to call it heterozygous. There is no difference in terms of heterozygous dominant or heterozygous recessive. They meant the same thing because it's just interchange. However, use the word heterozygous is enough. How do we write a dominant allele? We write it using the uppercase letter for dominant. While a recessive allele, we use a lowercase. Now, this is because the capital letter is able to distinct itself from the small letter. However, if you have other characters, right, like let's say C, both are of the same shape. How are you able to differentiate an uppercase and lowercase? We tend to write a line underneath the lowercase to represent it as a recessive allele. But for O level, my advice is to choose letters that are distinctly different. For example, A. B. C. And so on and so forth. In exam questions so far, these can come out as an O-level question and generally it's the last question for structure questions, structure paper. And what will happen is based on these, right, you will be given, you might be given the legend of what alphabet to use. So do read the question very carefully and to avoid being to avoid being penalized for your answers. Okay. So when we look at this, now we look at PQR. PQR are basically the offspring, the name of the offspring that we give. And we see that P has homozygous recessive because both are small letter, right? And then Q has a homozygous dominant, which is both are capital letter. And R is heterozygous because one big A and one small a. Now what we can see is also the letters are the genotype. For phenotype, we realize that the small letters represent white color, whereas the capital letters, they represent purple color. So what we can tell is the purple color represents the dominant allele, whereas the white color represents the recessive allele. So in the event that A, capital A being more dominant than small letter A, you realize that for organism R, they tend to also be purple in color because capital A, which codes for purple color, is more dominant than the recessive allele that codes for white color. So for the phenotype, the physical characteristics is actually observed of the organism. And how would you be able to write it down in your answer is that if they ask you for phenotype, for organism P, you have to say that the flower is white color. Whereas for phenotype for Q and R, you can say that the flower is purple color. However, if they ask you for the genotype, which is the genetic makeup of the organism, for organism P is small a, small a. For organism Q is big A, big A. And organism R is actually big A, small a. It is always a convention way of writing the dominant allele letter first, followed by the recessive allele. And what we will also be exploring is how are we able to model genetic crosses? That means draw the permutations so that the genetic models can be used and allowing us to be able to explain which gene will flow to where, as well as what are the traits being expressed. Okay, I will stop here for now. Do take the time to actually review the chapter, and I'll see you.